My job on this panel is to act as moderator. If you want to know about me, you'll read the biography of speakers and panelists. My name is in there. It's Ruben Friedman. Don't forget that.
Don't forget it.
You will also see a little paragraph on each of the panelists. I encourage you to get to know the panelists. There are two people who are intimately involved in the original Japanese-Canadian redress from the community side, Connie Sugihara and Art Miki, who was the president of the NAJC at the time. And we have two people who were intimately involved in the negotiations from the government side, Anne Scotton, who was part of the government negotiating team, and the Honorable Jerry Weiner, who was the minister responsible for multiculturalism and citizenship at the time. So both of these people, all of these people had a significant role. So we want to hear from all the panel members in terms of what I just talked about, the kinds of lessons to learn from the past. And I want to start this off, if you'll permit me, by asking the members of the panel to take a few moments to talk about the past. For the people who were working on behalf of the government, I'd like to ask you, what did you see, what did you experience as the obstacles inside the government to concluding this agreement? And number two, what do you think had to be accomplished in the general public in order to conclude the agreement? If you would just take a few moments to talk about that. And I would like to ask a similar question for people who were in the community at the time. What were the obstacles inside the community to concluding an agreement? And what did you see as necessary in terms of convincing the general public about the wisdom and the necessity and the justice of concluding the agreement? If I may, I would like to ask each person to give their perspective in turn. And if we could start with the Honorable Jerry Weiner.
Ruben, thank you very much. Can I be heard without the microphone? No? They used to say I was a voiceless backbencher, so here goes. Does this come on?
It's on.
Hello? Is this working? Can you hear me in the back? Okay. Better now? That's better? Okay. I had the pleasure of being elected to the federal parliament in 1984. A community activist from the city of Dollar de Zormo, a very diverse population, and with me today is Bashir Hussein, who at that time was the treasurer of my business, so he remained with me through all my political campaigns. So thanks, Bashir, for being here. The feeling I had a mandate letter from the Prime Minister when I became a minister. You get a mandate letter which outlines in brief detail what you're supposed to be doing. So it stated very clearly that I had the mandate to negotiate a settlement with Canadians of Japanese, with Japanese Canadians, with Canadians of Japanese origin. Now, I knew that at least three or four of our ministers failed in what they attempted in terms of the arrangements or the redress settlement that they'd been proposing. And all of them were top-down ramming to the community what they felt, what the government felt that they would want. And that, I told the Prime Minister, would not work. I wasn't going to be involved in that. If I did anything, it would be working with the community, finding common ground, because obviously we had to have some sessions where we had conversations of what the community thought they needed to get the community to support the package. And I knew what I thought I had to have to go back to the government. It was a government which wasn't always easy. I came from the left-wing side of the government. I'm a so-called red Tory. And we had others that were more on the right wing. And I guess some were far too focused on the cost, how much it would cost, the slippery slope. How much would we end up paying for this? And to me, cost had no, it was nothing to do with cost. It was having the understanding of a period which was so, I won't use the word deportable because they're going to fight about that in the United States. No, it was unbelievably outrageous to have taken an entire community of Canadians for no better reason than they look different, took away their citizenship, their business, their homes, interned them. So the whole thing was a staggering experience, just horrifying. And of course, other communities were affected to some extent, but never quite the entire community. This was a completely different experience. So I knew from my previous history that, and I'm a member of the Jewish community, and how almost an entire people were eliminated during the Holocaust. You know, this is, so I was touched by that, and I was touched by the fact I was given opportunity to do something that would mark me for life. And I could tell you that nothing I did in my life became more important than finding a way to bring forward a just and fair settlement with Canadians of Japanese origin. So the background was that once I had the mandate, of course the Prime Minister insisted that it was up to me to make sure that the caucus and members and ministers were going to be supportive. He said, you've got the job, don't worry about the funds, we'll have to find them. Just go to it, but you better get some of them aboard one-on-one. Now, when I started, I had one or two ministers that were quite supportive. I won't say we had 20 or 30. So it was a case of doing bilaterals one at a time, and Anne is going to smile because she knew what the scars every time there was a meeting. But fortunately, I had one or two very strong ones. In fact, one who was able to call the Prime Minister day or night and say, look, this is what Jerry needs. So the background was, it ended up that we went to Montreal. My senior minister at the time was Lucien Bouchard. He stayed 1 hour to say hello to the group at probably the Ritz-Carlton Hotel at that time. Yes. And I said, no, that's not my style. We're going to go up to the Delta Hotel. You know, more my speed, down to earth.
And
smoked meat sandwiches. Now, the first thing I did the first day is I called Schwartz's, and I ordered smoked meat sandwiches and fries. And I had them delivered. And I said, now we talk, Art. I don't know. You had 8 or 10 people. We all enjoyed the smoked meat. And we talked about what we needed. And we ended the week. We thought we had a deal. And we went back, and Art had his community support the idea. I went back, and I had the government support it, made sure it was put through. And here I am, almost 30 years later, still rejoicing in the fact that I was somehow involved in bringing forward a redress package for Japanese Canadians. And I can remember there was a night in 2013 when I was here on the 25th anniversary. I was so moved, I was moved to tears because I had an opportunity to speak. I gave chapter and verse the story of everything that took place, and I had standing ovations. Now, that never happened to me in anything else I've done in my life. So. Happy to be here again with you and happy to share a few reflections. It was a wonderful period, but one where it took a lot of work to make sure this happened. So, Ruben, that's a few thoughts. I mean, I have plenty of recollection, but a few thoughts on the period.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Anne Scotton if she can add anything to that.
Well, I think that first of all, I want to say what an honor it is to be invited, and an honor it's been in terms of my own career, probably the highlight of my career, actually achieving Japanese-Canadian redress, because it had been something that the Canadian government had been talking about for a long, long time, and I think a whole constellation of different things came together. The circumstances were right. We had a minister who was very very much committed. We had a senior minister who had been mandated to do it, whether he was committed or not. And we had, I think, a series of other supporters in government and in cabinet that worked together very effectively. I think, you know, at the outset, the facts, the evidence spoke for itself and themselves. There were 22,000 Canadians who were affected, whatever their origin, and many of them, of course, had been born in this country. Three quarters of them had been born in this country. And so I'm a political scientist, that's my training, and my master's degree is in Canadian studies. And so it was with amazement and some horror that I learned about the evidence that came behind some of the policy making that that inspired Japanese-Canadian redress. So 3,400 people were deported from this country, many of them who had been born here. And so they were Canadians, and they were deported to a country they'd never seen, and which didn't welcome them after a war that that country had lost. And so they were strangers in a stranger land, and yet they looked like the people that they were being returned to, in the words of the Canadian government. And in many ways, the children of people who had, in fact, immigrated or who had come to this country were the victims of something which was an absolute abomination. So from my perspective as a public servant, there was something I could do, and it was a unique and wonderful opportunity to actually take some action and put into effect some of the things that I believed in personally and which I had an opportunity to do on a personal and public service basis. So it was a lot of work, but I think too that the initiative was there, and between the leadership shown within the community by Art, and you'll hear from him himself, I've always been in love with Art Meakey, and it started many years ago, and I really feel that there was a unique combination of public service, community, and political will at the time that made it happen, and it happened because it was right. So those are the things I think are most important. I can speak now a little bit about the other factors. The media was for Japanese-Canadian redress, and the media absolutely exploded some of the myths about Japanese-Canadians, or they called them Japanese. They aren't Japanese. They're Canadians of Japanese origin. And some of the opinion polls that the government was running in order to gauge whether or not, and you know, you can be cynical about opinion polls, but if they go in your favor, you can use them very, very effectively to say, no, the time is right. The Canadian public understands that this is an absolutely important and public policy imperative to redress this situation. It had been at that time 40 years that the community had been fighting. The PricewaterhouseCoopers study, you mentioned, Mr. Weiner, that you know the public and the government is always obsessed with the money. Well, yes, they were obsessed with the money, but we had the proof that the community had lost, had been deprived, it had been stolen from the community, millions and millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. And that was something that wasn't just some public servant guessing in the air. PricewaterhouseCoopers had told us that it was that much money, and that spoke to Canadians. As well, the community itself, Japanese Canadians were active and full members of Canadian society and had been right from serving in the war, the same war that at its end sent Japanese Canadians, deported them to Japan. They had been active right through every aspect of Canadian society and in their communities had been strong and full participating members. So those things were the most important things, I think, in terms of the circumstances that allowed Japanese-Canadian redress to happen.
Thank you very much, Anne. And I'd like now to get a perspective from community members on what they saw as the difficulties within their community and within society at large in terms of achieving the kind of agreement which they finally achieved in 1988. If I could start with Connie, I'd like to get your perspective before I move to Art, if that's okay.
Thank you. Before Jerry was elected to Parliament, before Art was elected as the head of the NAJC, there were two very grassroots organizations, one in Vancouver. Art's brother Roy was part of that, and Cassandra Kobayashi, and a group in Toronto of which I was a founding member called Sodankai. Now, I was a very young lawyer at the time, and one of my classmates called me, it was in the early 80s, and said, did you hear something about an apology that is going to be made? It was more a statement of regret. And a $50 million fund for something, we didn't know what it was about, is going to be announced by the federal government. Well, we were stunned. I mean, this announcement had come from nowhere. And there was a member of our community who was behind that. And we got together. Now, it's probably, for those of you who are not members of the Canadian Japanese community, you might not appreciate that I'm really the first generation of lawyers in our community. Because if you grew up in British Columbia, even if you were born in Canada, you did not have the vote. And if you did not have the vote, there were certain professions from which you were excluded, and that included law. So there were a handful of Japanese Canadian lawyers who had gone to school in the East, but none from British Columbia. And so my generation is really the first to go through law school. So there was Cassandra, there was me, there was Marcia Matsui, Marika Omatsu, mm-hmm. and Shinny Maya. And we got together and basically said, so who asked us? Like, where did this suggestion come from? Who's behind it? It was a different administration. But fundamentally, what's this about? So we started digging, and it became clear that nobody really had consulted with the community. And one of the real challenges is that we were 22,000 people spread across the country. In my generation, in the next generation, Japanese Canadians have the highest rate of intermarriage. So the fourth generation in this country have names like Kirby, Sullivan, whatever, and they're mixed race. Very hard to, and we had done what we were told, and that was to go forth and integrate. So we were not the Japantown had gone in British Columbia. We were spread all over the country. So to try to organize a very disparate group of people who were really politically insignificant. Okay, we were not a large identifiable group as some other Asian groups now are. And how do you organize? How do you get people together? So the one thing that Sodankai did that I think was quite effective, and we couldn't have done it without the Japanese Canadian Cultural Center, who really risked their charitable status by allowing us to have meetings here in the auditorium. And what we did was we brought the Americans up here because they were going through a process where there was a guy named William Horry who was leading a group that wanted to sue the American government in a class action for redress. Then there was another guy named John Tateshi who represented the Japanese American Citizens League, and they were pursuing a redress solution. And then we also invited the guy who was working with the then administration to I'll put it nicely, sell us down the river, as it turns out. Mm-hmm. And we gave them a public forum, and we said, all right, you know, I think, first of all, we have to present the options. Now, the other thing that's important to remember is that the first and second generation Canadians of Japanese, they did not want to talk about this for the most part. Okay, some people have said the analogy is to rape victims. You know, something bad happened, and in many cases, the community blamed themselves, right? If we had been, well, what did we do to deserve this? They've lived with, there was no apology, and everybody just went about rebuilding their lives and did not want to talk about it. So that was the other challenge mm-hmm. for the community, was to even get people out to talk about this, because it was a traumatic mm-hmm. experience. You know, my parents, who were sitting in the front row, were 10 and 14 years old when they were uprooted and sent to the interior of British Columbia. As my father said, you know, they were put on a train, they didn't know where they were going, and nobody came to say goodbye. It was a very traumatic, hurtful experience for them. They were stripped of their property, and then at the end of the war, they were told to go east. So we had this tiny little community who just really didn't want to talk about it. We had a government of the day that was prepared to do something just to bury the whole thing and make it go away. And so in Vancouver and Toronto and in Hamilton and then in other centers, we just started to have a dialogue in the community. What are the options? And what is it that you would like to do? I mean, let's just talk about it. Get it aired first. If I were to say, what were the biggest challenges for us? One, I've mentioned small population, politically insignificant, geographically dispersed. The media was not supportive at all at the time. The rest of the community was not supportive. I mean, I'm a Bay Street lawyer, and I would go up and down the elevator, and when the discussions first started, I would hear people in the elevator saying, what do those Japs want anyhow? You know, didn't we beat them in this war? Like, what? Why should we apologize to them? I had a Jewish partner who said to me, this never happened. And I said, I can't believe that you are saying that. And I gave her copies of the books at the time that had been written. I said, read this, then we'll discuss it. But that was the view of the general public. And when the media did refer to us, they would refer to us as Japanese, which is sort of missing the point. So a group of us went out, and we met with the journalists, Ann Silversides, and there was a guy named Ben Fiber, who was a friend of Joy Kogawa's. And I gave them briefing books. I said, the reason we are seeking redress is because we're Canadian, okay? Not because we're Japanese. So call us Canadians of Japanese ancestry, and I'm really happy to use that term, because then if you drop part of it in the editing, you're going to drop the Japanese part and emphasize the Canadian part, because that's what distinguishes what we are trying to do. We're not seeking redress because we're Japanese. We're seeking redress because we're Canadians, and no Canadian should be stripped of their rights in an arbitrary fashion, in turn for 5 years. And then told to disperse if you weren't deported. So that was the issue. So slowly, we were able to change that dialogue in the media. But the biggest, I mean, two big challenges. One was, I mean, I think if you believe that you are fighting a just cause, you just assume that everybody else will get it, right? Well, you don't understand. We were really politically naive. So we did not understand why the government of the day did not get this. Well, my theory all along was the reason the government didn't get it was that if they apologized to us, they had invoked the War Measures Act in 1970. And so they would have to make an apology in the province of Quebec that would open a can of worms that was not politically good for them as a party. And so therefore they just wanted to bury it. And we fought them and we fought them. We went through, I don't know how many ministers of multiculturalism. The other challenge for us that the Americans did not have, the Canadian Legion mounted a campaign against us because, of course, our veterans had suffered terribly in the Hong Kong garrison. You know, they were sort of cannon fodder. And so they actually opposed us in a very vocal way. Now, that happened in the United States. The American Legion said, why should we compensate? Why should we, you know, do anything for the Japs? And then they would put Daniel Inouye on television with his one arm, Mike Masaoka, because they had a distinguished record in the Second World War. The 442nd was the most highly decorated unit in the Second World War. And so every time the American Legion said something, Daniel Inouye would go on television, he would say, What do you mean? I'm an American. I lost my arm in Italy. And our families were sitting in concentration camps in the desert while we signed up to fight. Japanese Canadians were not allowed to fight in the Second World War. We fought in the First World War. But the government, British Columbia, said, you cannot allow these people to serve in the army, because if you do, you have to give them the vote. I mean, it's really the most perverse logic. And so therefore, Japanese Canadians were excluded from the armed forces. We had, except for a tiny little group that were recruited by the British Army to go into occupied Southeast Asia with the British Army, but then the Canadian government said, well, maybe you can't leave in British uniforms. We'll give you Canadian uniforms. And it was just a tiny little group. So we had no answer to the Canadian Legion. And they actually went to sue the Japanese government for $21,000 each for the survivors of the Hong Kong garrison. again, missing the point that we were Canadian, and as horrible as their experience was and how inexcusable it was, the two issues were completely separate. So those were sort of the challenges, and this all, and so trying to get the community together, trying to get the media behind us, trying to rally support in the public through, you know, there really was a bit of a coalition of the willing, but the real difficulty was the political, I would say, duplicity in Ottawa, that when Art was elected as the head of the NHAC, things would happen and we wouldn't know about it. They would have rallies, they would put the person who was going to accept the largesse of the government, and we wouldn't know about it. We wrote to them, we did, you know, we would, to, and it was clear that whatever we were about to do, the government knew before us. So there was a leak somewhere in the government. And there was a point where I didn't know who was on what side. That was, it was really that, and who was talking to which branch of the government. I went up to, and I'm not told too many people this, but I've now had an opportunity to interview John Fraser for our SDI project. But John Fraser from British Columbia was in opposition at the time, and I had an opportunity through some people I knew to go up and talk to him. So I took a briefing book up, and I just laid out the facts. This is what has happened so far. This is the chronology. Here are some articles. This is what we're trying to do. We're just having a dialogue right now, but these things keep happening, and it feels like somebody's going to pull the rug out from under us before we've even had a chance to decide what it is as a community we really want. Now, I'm telling you this story because I think for political action in the future, the lesson is this. You can't do this alone. Okay? You can't do it without making friends in the media. You can't do it without having some very articulate, powerful people in the broader community. And you can't do it without having some friends in high places. And the Honorable John Fraser was one of them. And interestingly, he had lived in Japan. His father was a Macmillan Bladel executive. And John had spent his early childhood in Japan. And when he came back and after Pearl Harbor, he was beaten up. He was called a Jap. And he was beaten up, sometimes pretty badly. In one case, he said he worked in a sawmill. And it was the Japanese-Canadian Nisei men who actually protected him from the white bullies who were calling him a Jap because he had lived in Japan, who protected him. But when the Japanese-Canadian community was interned, John's father took him to the World War I Memorial in Stanley Park. And he said, John, I fought with these people. They fought for their country in the First World War. And what we're doing is wrong. And he said, someday you're going to have to do something to make this right. And the other person who helped us, and Anne had mentioned the Price Waterhouse Cooper study, was a guy named Phil Barter. And I had heard that he was behind Price Waterhouse doing this study, which really turned the tide for us in the redress discussion, because what it did was it put some evidence-based material together, which, you know, we couldn't prove what we'd lost because government took all our records. And so we couldn't prove the economic losses. And Pricewaterhouse did that study. And I had an opportunity to speak to Phil Barter. He's passed away since. And I said, you know, is it true? Because people who do things like this are very modest and they don't talk about it. So John Fraser never talked about it. You know, he was, I think, influential in caucus when the Conservative Party came into power in pushing this forward. And Phil Barter was another. He was a partner of Price Waterhouse, and he convinced the firm that they should do this study basically at cost. And it turned the tide. And when I asked him, I said, you know, why did you do this? Why was this important to you? And he said his best friend was Japanese-Canadian.
And he and his father went to see them off the train station. And his father said, you know, Phil, this isn't right. He said, it's not right what we're doing. These are Canadians. And so Phil said, he was still a kid. He said, I'd do something about this someday. And he said, and this is one small thing that I could do. And it really did change the tide. So I'm going to stop there because I just want it to sort of lay the, you know, the result was very successful. But for others who are looking at seeking redress, other Canadians, you know, we hope that this doesn't happen to any other group of Canadians. But the challenges of trying to mobilize and trying to organize, it was like being in mud for a while. I mean, there were hardly any of us. We were spread across the country. I will say, in support of the legal profession, that it did make a difference to have people. It did make a difference to have lawyers in the group. And it might have made a difference, because it did for the Americans, to have had second-generation lawyers during the internment. The Americans only spent 2 years in the camps. Canadians spent at least 4 to 5 years. Americans were never deported, because their constitution would not allow American citizens to be deported. The U.S. Supreme Court released everybody from the camps because they said, you cannot keep American citizens imprisoned without trial. So they were released. Our government didn't do that, okay? But it was because they had lawyers and they had in the community legally trained, qualified lawyers. They were able to make these arguments. They were allowed to fight. We weren't allowed to fight. Americans' property, they did not have their property confiscated because the U.S. Constitution will not allow the confiscation of the property of U.S. citizens. We had no such right here. So there's a big difference. So again, I know everybody loves to hate lawyers, but it did make a difference in the final analysis, just in terms of trying to mobilize and organize and understand the laws and understand what the government could and couldn't do. And yeah, that's all I'm going to say. Art, it's your turn.
Well, thank you.
I just want to say if Art could also add anything in terms of future possible redress issues and what we've learned so far, how that will apply to the future. Oh,
okay. Well, I thought I'd like to pick up on a few things that have been said, because you know what was said up to this point has been very important. I know one of the questions, what were the main obstacles, and as Connie alluded, initially, our community had difficulty supporting the whole concept of redress. And I can understand that because they were afraid of backlash, they were afraid of racism as well, and being a very small community, we're not much of a political force. So that was one of the issues. But the other big issue that occurred in our community was division. We had groups of people who felt that what they would be satisfied would be to have some community fund. There were others who felt that there should be individual recognition, because it wasn't just the community who lost the property or their jobs, it was the individuals in our community who lost, and that there should be a recognition for that as well. So there was this conflict that brewed within our community, and it got fairly brutal in terms of the comments that were made. And you know, when Connie refers to the fact that perhaps there were some inside contacts that the government knew about, well, you know, that I think it came from that aspect of it, when because I remember the first time I met Aldo Jelinek, first meeting, Winnipeg Airport. He was on his way back from Calgary because of the Winter Olympics. And so he calls the meeting, and his chief of staff, the first thing he said to me is, "Oh, it's nice to see you, Mr. Oki." Now, for those people who know this, Mr. Oki is from Toronto, very much opposed to what we're doing, and that's the first thing that the chief of staff said to us, is, "Welcome, it's nice to see you, Mr. Oki," and I triggered you know, right away I said, I'm Art Mickey. He's old. And so when we met with Otto Jelinek in this private meeting, and the first thing he said to us, he says, you know, I really understand your situation. He says, you see, I'm an immigrant. And one of our guys in there, Harold Hirosa, said, hold it. You don't understand us because we were Canadians. And that's the kind of misinterpretation that people had. When they looked at Japanese, they thought that they were immigrants, essentially not here for several generations. And so the concept of being Canadians of Japanese ancestry was very important. I could tell you that there was one male that, well, what happened, this is in reference to it, we had held a press conference in Vancouver. It went nationally, it was on the national news. I get a phone call from the Consul General in Edmonton. And he said to me, he says, would you, association, consider dropping the redress movement? Because he says, you're hurting our relations with Japan and Canada. And I said, first of all, we're Canadians. You know, it's our issue, not something to do with Japan. Well, I said, why are you saying this to me? And he said, we received a hate letter that someone sent to the Japanese consulate office saying that if we don't drop this issue, those people will be killed who were on this TV program for the press conference. And he said, it's getting to a point where it's threatening, and therefore, if you would drop it, then this, you know. And so I said, no, there's no way that we would do that. And so we continued. We ignored it and said, sorry, but we are not willing to abide by it. But the reason I say that is because people who are watching this appear to think that we were Japanese Japan rather than Canadians. And that's the conflict that was there. I had nasty phone calls from veterans as well, same thing. You know, look what you did to us. And I said, hold it, I didn't do anything to you. I was born here. I have no relationship in terms of contact with Japan. We didn't do anything, we're Canadians. And you know, it was interesting, I had this irate call one night, and I said to him, look, if you were in my shoes and someone came and took your property away, would you let that happen? He says, there's no way I would let that happen. He says, I would fight it. I said, essentially, that's what we're doing. We're trying to let people know that our community lost things, and therefore we have a right to speak out against it. And you know, at the end, when he understood the relationship, he said to me, he says, you know what, I support you. And so it was that kind of dialogue that occurred, because the first thing he said to me was, look what you did to us. You know, it was this misinterpretation again. So that was one of the difficulties that we had. And I know in our press conferences, we always made sure we made reference to Canadians. It was very important because there was that situation. I just want to mention Price Waterhouse too, and I appreciate Connie giving the background. But you know, I mean, here's the example. Our community had difficulty really being very supportive of us at that point in time. That was 2 years into the redress movement, conflicts within. We did a fundraising campaign because we found out that it would cost us $150,000 to do this study. And I remember we applied to the government for funding, and they said, I remember minister said to us, he said, why would we fund you and then you'll use the study against us? Logical, right? I said, well, there are examples I could cite that you did support situations where it was used against you. But anyways, they said, no, we're not going to fund you. So we did a fundraising campaign in our community, and all we could come up with was about $30,000. Because, again, as I said, there are a lot of people who were very skeptical that anything would ever happen I think that was the big fear, that we're wasting our time and money. And so when Pricewaterhouse came and Phil Barker said that they would do it, remember saying to them, if we ever get redress, we'll pay you. And he agreed to that. And Jerry will recall, because when we did the final agreement, we built in the $150,000 for Pricewaterhouse, so they got paid, so they were happy. So that was great. The other part I just want to mention is we're talking about, Connie referenced the differences between American and Canadian, and when we were into negotiations for the Japanese-Canadian individual compensation, we got to a point where we were going to settle for $20,000, similar to the American. And this is where we said to Jerry, and you know, he was very accommodating, we said, look, symbolically, we were treated worse than the Americans. Surely, we could get a little bit more than the Americans. And so Jerry said, well, we could maybe reduce the community fund and but we'll give you $1,000 more. And that's how we arrived at $21,000, because people say to me, why would you settle? Where did this $21,000 come? What was the symbolism? So I explained to them what the symbolism is. And then some people have told me after, he says, you know what? You realize that the American dollar was worth a lot more at the time. And I said, well, it's a symbolism. Yeah, we weren't Americans either. But interesting enough, those are things. And, but the other part I'd like to share is that after the redress, I was quite involved with the Aboriginal community and the Assembly of First Nations. And when they were looking for the residential school settlement, and I remember at one point the government had come in to say that they were prepared to compensate those people who were physically and sexually abused, but not the rest of the people. And I remember Phil Fontaine called me and says, you know, you gotta come out and speak to our group. So I went to Vancouver, big gathering. There are 1,500 Aboriginal people there. And so I spoke to them about the importance of recognition, because in our case, it was basically based on the loss of individual rights. The $21,000 was not for property losses and so on. It was the fact that every one of those people whose rights were deprived during that period of time, and the $21,000 symbolically to every one of those individuals was the same, because each one was deprived of their rights. And that's how we arrived at it. Because I've had some people say, well, I lost property, my neighbor had nothing, and they get the same amount. And I try to explain the whole concept behind our settlement was based on the loss of rights and not property or anything else. And that was a common element for all of the Japanese, whether they lived in British Columbia or Alberta or Ontario, they were eligible for redress, because during that period of time, Japanese, whether, didn't matter where you lived, you could not move freely in this country. So that was the basis for it. And just to close off, Anne referenced going to Japan, or she didn't reference, but helping those people who were sent to Japan. And I have to, you know, commend the government at the time for allowing a group of us to go to Japan to hold meetings across Japan, 10 cities in 14 days, I believe.
Yeah.
And we met, 8 or something, 100 people.
850.
850, there you are. But the part that really was intriguing was the fact that National NHK television crew followed us for three or four days. And they followed us because they were quite intrigued at what our government was doing to send a delegation to another country to seek out people who were eligible, and also to go send people there to, you know, essentially give away money. And so the Japan Press was quite intrigued, and they kept saying, why is the government sending people out to find people to give money to them? They couldn't understand the concept because they said in Japan that likely would never happen. And when we met with the one of the external affairs at in Tokyo, and he listened to us and he said, you know, he says, Japan may be a country that's highly automized, they're quite ahead in certain things, but he said to us, Japan would never be able to apologize the way Canada did. And he said to us, he says, you know, it takes a mature country to do that. And I really appreciated those words because I realized that Canada is a very young country in relation to any of the other countries, and yet we were considered in the area of human rights to be a very mature country. So those are some of the comments. I never answered Ruben's question, okay. But we might be able to get to it.
Oops. Actually, we're coming close to the end of this session. So in one or two sentences, I'm wondering if each of you could summarize what you think are the important lessons for the future in terms of bringing communities together to deal with redress issues.
It may take me 3 or 4 minutes, but allow me. Look, redress has provided us with a common law of all the events which serve to guide us in what behavior is appropriate today. Guide us in truly saying and feeling these events should never happen again. That we have matured as a society, the true value for apologizing. But I can tell you, when I pick up Monday morning Journal de Montréal, and it says, Le pays qui n'avait pas d'identité. This is in Montreal, 24th of October. Three times in the last decade, we're going to be fighting the issue of whether we have Quebec values or whether we have Canadian values, how divisive this is. So Richard Martineau writes this story that we have no value, that we have no soul, that we have no history, and all that. And then 125 people comment in the first hour. So what we have before us is things are good. Either Brian Mulroney or the teaching of the Buddha said, if you judge me alone, you may think I haven't done so well, but compare me to others, I haven't done so bad. But we better be very vigilant. We're still being faced with racism, intolerance, and even xenophobia. You know, there's no patting ourselves on the back. We must be very vigilant, not remain silent, and learn from the experience of the redress. Use it as something, as a teaching experience, but there are danger signals again. Other communities are being so affected. We just had a federal election campaign which deteriorated into almost a frontal attack on race, ethnicity, and culture. And I won't go much beyond that because they're supposed to be my friends. So I think that if there's one thing we do is not to remain silent, it's to scream out. I mean, I've always asked myself, how did those people remain silent in those years when it was being done to other Canadians? Why did they remain silent? Would I have remained silent had I been there? And there's no answer, except that being here today, commemorating, because it's not a celebration, it's redress, it's a commemoration of the events those events. And we at least should learn that as individuals, when something like this happens, scream out, that's the injustice. Don't allow them to do it to us. And again, I'm very thankful to have been able to participate in this moving experience. It's changed my life, and I'll never be quiet again when I see something happen. And whether it's in the French press of Monday morning or in the National Assembly, which should be minding their own business, I think we all have to be vigilant. And I'm thankful that you're here, and perhaps you too will be very vigilant. Thanks again.
That was so eloquent. I'm not sure I can add anything to it other than to say, you know, if we don't learn from the mistakes of our past, we're bound to repeat them. And, you know, we look at what's happening, the discussion, if you can call it a discussion that is happening south of our border, it's happening in France, it's happening in Germany, it's happening in England. And, you know, I think we Canadians have a real opportunity to show the rest of the world how, you know, a group, there's only one group, and it's our Indigenous people who are truly Canadian. The rest of us came over here on boats or planes or whatever else. And I think we have a tremendous opportunity to be an exemplar in the rest of the world as to how we take a diverse population and learn to live together. And I think we can only do that if we start talking about these issues. I think if we don't, and this organization, I think, is helping with that dialogue, if we don't talk about it openly, if we don't, you know, as we did early on in the redress section, we let the people who were about to sell us down the river talk. And the more they talked, the more it was apparent that they didn't really have a very good case. Mm-hmm. And you have to have that dialogue, and we have to have that dialogue among all Canadians. And so I hope that there is a lesson from this. And it takes political leadership. It takes leadership in the community, which is art. It takes leadership within our public service. It takes leadership in the media. And if a tiny little community of 22,000 can do it, you know, it can be done. I think if there's a lesson from this, it's that.
Thank you.
I would say that the turning point in our redress campaign took place in 1986. At that point, we had met with one of the ministers in charge of multiculturalism. He essentially said to us, this is take it or leave it. In other words, take the $12 million community fund and the acknowledgement, or if you don't accept it, that's the end of any discussion with the government again. So that was the ultimatum we faced. And I remember we walked away from that table saying, you know, we can't live in our community if something happens whereby things change, like the American bill being passed, et cetera. We would be the laughingstock. So we walked away from it. And at that point, we had to decide, how do we move this movement in a different direction? And what we decided to do was to make redress a Canadian human rights issue. And by doing that, it meant that we brought other Canadians on board. Tom Berger in Vancouver agreed to be the honorary chair. People like Joy Kagawa brought in people like Pierre Burton, Margaret Atwell, all of those Canadians. We had hired a person, and he contacted all the unions in Canada, and most of the major unions were supporting us. In fact, they were sending letters to Ottawa as well. Jean-Claude Perrault, I remember, and Bob White for the United Auto Workers, and these people made a difference. All the churches, major churches in Canada, supported us. And so we had the groundswell of other Canadians. And to me, that was a turning point of our campaign, because when we marched on Ottawa the day that Jerry was there, we had other Canadians speaking up in support of redress. And shortly after that, the picture changed. By that time, the American bill had been passed. It became a precedent for especially individual compensation. And so the tables changed. And, you know, we're very fortunate that I still believe that we were there at the right time when all of these things came together to result in the final solution. And so that's, and I guess what my message is, if you have a cause, you have to get other Canadians in support, helping you. Because as Connie mentioned, 22,000 is the smallest ethnic community in the country right now of Asians. we're the smallest, and yet when we look around, we've made a lot of impact over the years in our Canadian society. But the involvement of other people is very important if you want to move any action ahead.
So I just want to thank all the other panelists for many of the things that I would have liked to say. I'd just like to add that the War Measures Act was a huge, huge stumbling block, and it was something that was worked through in about 3 months, finally, to get the Act repealed. And part of the reason that the Act was repealed is because no Canadian of Japanese origin was ever charged or convicted of any crime during the entire war period, which was part of the reason that we were told that this was necessary to move Canadians 100 miles back from the coast so that they couldn't be in touch with Japanese enemies. They couldn't have radios, they couldn't freely associate, they couldn't hold meetings, they couldn't talk to each other. Some of them disguised themselves as Chinese Canadians because God knows Canadian of white origin didn't know the difference. So these are the kinds of things that are really, in this day and age, we think about it and we laugh because it's so insane. But at the time, I think, now 25, 28 years ago, I think that that was the thing that made the difference. I think you're right, Art, and I think all the panelists have probably referred to it in their own way. But I think it's important to note, and I don't believe that it's because the Americans did what they did. They did it on August 12th. Trust me, I was following the American debates. And we did it on September 22nd, and we knew what our negotiating mandate was long before it was done by Ronald Reagan in the U.S. So, and we knew exactly what you pointed out, which is that Canadians were interned, and their internment was paid for by the proceeds of the sales of their homes and their businesses.
Yeah.
That's not what happened in the U.S. for 2 years or any other time. It was an absolutely, it's an abomination what happened. And that's why Canada, in their wisdom, believed that it was unique and unparalleled. There is no other community that has been discriminated against, has been treated with such absolute disregard to human rights, and in such a racist way, ever in history. Not the Komagata Maru, not the, you know, Jews, one is too many. None, no other community has been hunted and decimated and their community destroyed in the way that Aboriginal, that, so now I want to just say that where I work now is Indigenous Affairs and Northern Development. And it's a much bigger, much longer, and in some ways even sadder story, because they don't have the wherewithal. Many of the communities that I work with don't have the wherewithal. They don't have many lawyers, although many more than
yet.
Than they, that, yes. And they don't have the kind of basis or community integrity and community support that I think Japanese Canadians had and have. So that's something I think you mentioned that your brother, that you and that many others in the Japanese Canadian community have supported Indigenous peoples, have supported Aboriginal causes over the years. And I think that it's one of the very important ways to give forward mm-hmm. is to be thankful for what we have.
Thank you. Yeah.
We've come to the end of the panel this evening. I just wanted to mention one thing on my own behalf, which is that I was involved in multiculturalism for 20-odd years, that I worked in the department under the Honorable Jerry Weiner, that Ann Scotton was my colleague, and that I had the fortune to be the second acting executive director of Japanese Canadian Redress for a very brief time, all of which allowed me to learn so much about what had happened in the past and to get a much better grasp on the totality of Canadian history. And so all of us on this panel have been affected in some way by that experience. It's part of the reason that I'm a member of the board of the Canadian Race Relations Foundation. So it's been a strong motivator for a lot of people, and I hope it's a strong motivator for everyone here and everyone not here to take appropriate action in the future. With that, I would like you all to join me in thanking our distinguished panel for an informative and moving evening.